Welcome to part two on the Eucharist during this year of Eucharistic revival, as we've been talking about Corpus Christi and the solemnity of the Sacred Heart, and we have more that we'd like to share with you.
So you're in part two right now.
Right, so go to part one if you haven't seen it yet.
Yes. Should we tell them to subscribe to our channel if they wanted to?
Sure, yes, on YouTube.
It's Missionaries of Our Mother of the Eucharist. All right, our greatest human yearning, sister.
Right, so this is what Pope St. John Paul II says. I guess the question to ask is, what is your greatest human yearning? If you were to think of it right now, what is your greatest human yearning? Pope John Paul II is speaking of this in one of his last writings to us on the Eucharist.
And some people may be yearning for different things.
Right.
Some people may have disordered yearnings.
Exactly. And is it wrong for them to acknowledge that within themselves?
No, they need to be real.
Exactly. You have to be real no matter what your greatest yearning is, because underlying every disordered yearning that we have, there is this God-sized yearning. This yearning for the infinite, infinite love of God. And yet, the spirit of the world, the flesh, and the devil will try to draw us to sate that infinite longing that we have with something finite.
Something that is
something disordered.
Right.
And so that's where things get out of order in our lives, when we place things of this world before God and we don't have Him first, which is the first commandment. Love the Lord your God. And to love the Lord your God with your whole heart, mind, soul, and strength.
Amen.
And so this is very much connected with the Eucharist, because Pope St. John Paul II tells us what our greatest yearning is.
He does. He said, God has placed in human hearts a hunger for His Word, a hunger which will be satisfied only by full union with Him. Eucharistic communion was given so that we might be sated with God here on earth in expectation of our complete fulfillment in heaven. John Paul II, Mane Nobiscum, Domini 19.
Most of us don't read his writings to us, but they're so powerful.
And he's got a lot of them.
His writings, and especially on the Rosary and on the Eucharist.
Yes.
And so an encouragement to all of you, if you feel that something's missing in your life at the heart of growing in this union with our Lord and really knowing what life is all about, is our Lord in the Eucharist.
Amen.
I know that's what helped me to grow in coming to know my true dignity and identity. When I would go and start spending time in adoration, it was like looking into a mirror and coming to know my identity in Christ rather than my identity in what others thought of me, which is always what it was. I didn't know who I was, but as I spent time in Eucharistic adoration, I was coming to know my true identity and dignity.
As you were sharing that about finding your identity in Jesus in the Eucharist, I was just having this image of today, so many don't even know what that means, because our identity is found in...
What is that, your cell phone?
Ah, yeah.
Right,
cell phone.
Right.
So many people are looking at their cell phone and saying, this person liked me, this person loved me, this person, and they're looking at that.
Their identity is in what others, how others validate them.
Right.
In their life, in their disordered ways or ordered ways, whatever it may be.
And God wants to go to the core of who you are and touch you in the depths of who you are and His Eucharistic presence.
And reveal His love to you. That's first and foremost. He doesn't first and foremost say, you should not do that. He first and foremost says, I love you.
Right.
And I want you to know my love more. So come to me. Come to me, present in the Eucharist. So
I love that picture. So, that's so beautiful.
I know. So Pope John Paul II goes on to say this.
Receiving the Eucharist means entering into a profound communion with Jesus. Abide in me and I in you. This relationship of profound and mutual abiding enables us to have a certain foretaste of heaven on earth. Is this not the greatest of human yearnings? Mm-hmm. Sister, I want to ask you a question.
Yes.
What does that mean to you? Abide in me and I in you. That says a lot, doesn't it?
You want me to tell you what it means?
I would love to hear what your take is on that.
It means intercourse of the heart. It means that intimacy of life with God that we're longing for, that so many people are seeking in disordered ways. So many are caught up in sexual sin of all different kinds because they're getting deceived by the evil one to think that that deep ache that we all have for intimacy, that they're being deceived that it'll be sated by these finite things.
Creatures and things, yes.
Yes, yes. Whether it's even pornography, right. Whether it's another relationship, promiscuity of any kind, right. Fornication, anything outside of a chaste right. Marital relationship. Because God is meant to sate that deep longing we have.
Right.
And he really does if we expose and dispose our hearts to him. And that's the key, that we have to expose our hearts to him and really share those parts of our heart that we're struggling with. The areas that we might be ashamed of, areas that we might feel stuck in habitual sin. We need to talk to our Lord about this. And invite him in because he wants to untwist or put it in right order and he wants to validate our legitimate longing that we have, that we're acting out in a disordered way, but we have an underlying legitimate longing and Jesus wants to come in and he wants to heal us and he wants to sate that legitimate longing that we have for communion and for love. And for intimacy.
You know, sister, it used to be so easy for me to think that Jesus wants to abide in you or that person or that person, but does he really want to abide in me? And the answer is yes, of course he wants to abide in me. But you know, that when you think of the word abide, it's literally he wants to live in me. And he wants me to live in him.
Right.
And that is transforming union.
And if you would even think of someone that you love giving you a big hug, a very loving hug, and for Jesus to be abiding in us, he is hugging us through and through.
Mm.
He is permeating us and consuming us with his love, not just an external hug, but a hug that permeates, he abides in us, and he allows that love to permeate us to the deepest core of who we are if we allow him to enter in.
Oh, it's just so amazing, you know, that God wants this, you know, and the evil one is trying to just take that away because he wants us to abide in him. The devil wants us
right.
to abide in the evil.
He wants us not to come to the fullness of who we're created to be. He wants us to go in the opposite direction.
He wants to distort everything.
Right.
That everything that Jesus has ordered, everything that God has
right.
ordered, he wants to disorder.
Right.
You know, and twist it.
Because when we go toward our Lord, then he's losing.
Right.
So, yes. Jesus is waiting for us. And, of course, this is the two hearts.
The Sacred Heart and the Immaculate Heart.
Yes, and Mary is our model. Mary is the key to helping us to learn how to dispose our hearts more to Jesus and to receive more of his love.
I love that, you know, they're both like just pointing to their open hearts.
Right. Yeah. And you see our hearts right like, here.
Yeah,
because it's the two hearts. And our hearts are called to be exposed as well. And I just want to share with you what I have really been touched with when I went to Eucharistic adoration. And I know I've shared this at times, but when I first started going to adoration and realizing that Jesus is truly present among us,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, all growing up, I never wanted to be a religious sister. And I used to think it was if you couldn't find a husband or were unpopular or boring. And the thought of being the bride of someone you can't see or hear or feel, which is what a sister is supposed to be. How can you be the bride of someone you can't see or hear or feel? It was so foreign to me. But as I started spending time with Jesus in the Eucharist, I got to know Jesus intimately. And it got to a point where I said, wow, I really could be his bride, because I started to see him with my spiritual eyes, to hear him in the silence of my heart, and to feel him in the depths of my soul. As I was starting to exercise my spiritual senses, I said, beautiful. I really could be his bride. And that's what started my conversion to wanting to consecrate my life to Jesus, because I was starting to receive a grace to transcend the natural realm and to exercise my spiritual senses. And that's what we would like to encourage all of you to do. This is one of the graces of Eucharistic adoration. And this is why, you know, people will say, well, I wish Jesus was present now like he was 2,000 years ago to the apostles and disciples. But in fact, it's better for us now to have him in the Eucharist, because it helps us to transcend the natural realm. Because even the apostles and disciples had to do that. And Jesus even said to St. Thomas, blessed are those who do not see but believe.
Amen.
More blessed.
Amen.
When you don't see and you believe, because you have a faith. And so we encourage all of you to really come to know Jesus present in the Eucharist. Start exercising your spiritual senses and getting to know Jesus personally. Let him become your best friend. Share heart to heart with him.
He wants to be.
And invite him in. You receive a lot of healing that way, don't we?
Yes. He wants to be our best friend, you know?
Every time, if you ever have any problems, share them with Jesus. Share them with Mary. And so many graces flow. So we love you all. We encourage you to join with us in promoting devotion to our Eucharistic Lord throughout these 3 years of Eucharistic revival in our country and in our world.
Amen.
God bless you all.
Jesus in the Most Blessed Sacrament, we love you.
Our Mother of the Eucharist, pray for us.